Hey guys, it's Spaulding here and welcome to another deck profile video. And this time we got Otto's IDC 40 winner deck list, and it's light, darkness, fire nature, or grip survivors. And I will talk about the build which you see on the screen, also some comments from him, some thought process from me, and yeah, going through some matchups, not against specific decks, but rather against specific deck types like aggro, midrange, and control. And yeah, let's jump right into it. So first of all, when looking at the deck, we'll see that he is playing 50 cards. So there are two different approaches, in my opinion, to play survivors. The one is to play 40 cards or near to 40 cards, maybe 41, 42. And the other is just play like a control deck, go up to 50 cards. In my opinion, because I also played Darkness, Fire, Nature, survivors with light, added light, because in my opinion, it's the better version. And like, he finished top 8, or Otto finished top 8 in multiple times this championship IDC cycle now, and finally managed to win. So proven that this deck is better than just the Darkness, Fire, Nature version. But when you go up to 50 cards, you basically lose like all this consistency with the dream curve in turn 3 Brawlsome Tribe, and next turn you have the factory shell and mana. You play Soul Swap onto your Brawlsome Tribe, get the factory shell out, search for a smash on, play the smash on, and search another survivor, and this is all on turn 4. So especially when he's cutting like the fourth factory shell here, only playing three like this curve, he is not likely to see this curve at all. And that's why I'm a big fan of playing like close to 40 cards in this version with light together, to come close to like the original version without light. But by adding light, you get more mileage out of the Sky Sword, of course, which is huge against other control decks, and also helps you to ramp for the Lost Soul. Not that survivors has problems like against control decks. Usually against like any control deck without fire, it doesn't have like any problems. Against like deck out, which plays like 40 four snares, some blizzards, and so on, this could be tough when like all your grave worms, for example, get snared, or all your factory shells get snared. This could be a problem. And then, yeah, the rest are getting like slashed out. I think it's better to like slash the grave worm, to slash the factory shell and snare the grave worm. Of course, the opponent always gets something. That's a huge plus of the survivors in comparison to like the light, darkness, fire, nature control with Rias engine. Rias doesn't do like anything when it comes down, but like factory shell and grave worm like always do something, get a search in, get a grave recursion back in. So control usually struggles with it. Yeah, against deck out could be tough, or like any control deck that plays like fire mass removal and four snares, which is at the moment only Ruby deck out. But yeah, coming back to like the 40 to 50 card comparison, of course Brawlsome Tribe is your best play on turn 3, and so Otto added two slash chargers to help to turn 3 ramp. And slash charger can be useful here to search like one of the three factory shells of your own, so targeting yourself with the slash charger, getting it in the graveyard, and next turn playing down the grave worm, get back factory, and the turn after that you can play the factory shell from your hand. Also, when you slash your opponent, of course, knowing what's in their deck, And then assuming what could be in their shields is a huge plus if especially the only thing you would care about is an Holy Orb when you attack with Gargantua and have a huge board. So yeah, you can scout if your opponent has like if you know how many Holy Orbs he's playing, if there are any left in the deck with Slash Charger. But Slash Charger, of course, not the best turn 3 ramp, nothing gets over like the Brosam Tribe. And when you play like 40 cards, you would naturally cut the Slash Charger, so you have like just seeing your best cards like on time more often. That's just like the argument for 40 cards survivor. Yeah, some other decisions here, opting for one Belix and the Truyas, which he said are the flex spots here from his perspective. And yeah, when you go down a factory shell, you need some advantage generating card which needs to be answered immediately. So naturally, Rias jumps in there. Also, he's playing like the one Rebirth. So really many five drops running around, so you can collect the opponent Rias, the opponent Fal, the opponent Sky Sword, and search out either his Grave Worm or his Rias. Usually not the Sky Sword you want to see against aggros, against aggro deck, and aggro decks are usually not playing five mana creatures. So yeah, no Petrova here, which was quite surprising to me because Petrova name and survivors just boost like yeah, all your creatures. So I think there could be like a split here between like one Rias and one Petrova, and you can search them via Rebirth depending on your need. But again, when going down the factory shell and Mistyr's acting some sort of advantage engine, maybe you cut like the one Belix for the Petrova. But again, Belix could be nice as a Rebirth target here when you target your opponent's two drop like a Gonta or something, and then you need to get out a defensive two drop. Blazo doesn't help, and you can get out Belix, which is nice. But yeah, the Belix you most likely will never hard cast it on turn two, because you would need 16 light mana sources, and he only has 11. And in the four color version of survivors, there's just no room to go up even more in a color, which is not like nature, because all your stuff is basically in nature, and he's playing like 20 nature cards here. So all your other cards need to be divided into like light, darkness, and fire. And if you pump up like more light mana sources, you will lose in either fire or a darkness, and then you would lose some mana consistency there. He has enough darkness mana sources, 13 exactly, to have the consistency turn for Locomotiva. And on the fire section, you will again with the light section with Belix, with Blazo, you will never get like the consistency around 19%, 90% that you will play out Blazo. He's playing 11 there. Again, you would need 16, which is just not practical, but he has enough to play like the Tornado Flame. On turn 5, and Tornado Flame, another thing, acting as like the fourth pit, but is a better mana color. I think you would want like the fourth pit instead of like the first Tornado Flame if there was some space in the darkness section. But he also said that just coming down like one turn earlier, the Tornado Flame is nice in killing like the opponent's Rias. And even if the Rias gets boosted by a Paleolithus, it's still only 4k. So Tornado Flame acting most of the time as like a cheaper Terror Pit against all the aggro decks, especially, but also against some threats like Mistyr's and so on. Yeah, I really like the total distribution of the cards. There's like, yeah, only like not even a clear cut you would have to you or you could you can make or I would make. Still, I would find room for the one Petrova, cutting like, yeah, it's hard to cut because he even has cut it like the one factory shell, because nature mana is, as I said, with 20 cards, pretty full already, and yeah, so usually I would want to add like the fourth factory shell back again because you really need to see like either your factory shell or your Mysterias first, like on turn 5 or maybe even 4 with the Brosam Tribe or the Slash Charger, and if you don't see it, you basically like lose a turn. And in the tournament games, at least the ones I streamed, we saw Otto like struggling, just passing with like 4 or 5, 6 mana up, just charging mana and pass. Luckily, the opponent also like stumbled in their matches, or maybe they even played something. But as soon as he found like the factory shell, or as soon as he found the Rias and it sticked for a turn, the game was pretty much over. Because with factory shell, you either search your second factory shell, in case your first one gets destroyed, or you search like your grave worm. Searching grave worm when your factory shell gets destroyed is of course nice because it's like 1 mana cheaper. But if your factory shell gets swapped out, you have the grave worm, then factory shell is of course in your mana zone, not on the graveyard, so grave worm pretty useless. So usually it's like, do I search for cheap follow-up like Blazosaurus, or no, just Blazosaurus, I think, without the US at the end. So usually it's like, what do you expect the opponent to hold? Do you expect him to have like blank cards, or do you expect him to have like, yeah, a discard spell, or just a removal spell, or a swap, or whatever? So usually, if you want to hedge, you search like your second factory shell, and if you want to go off, then just search your Blazo and then chain the Blazo, chain smash on, and so on, and gain just huge board presence and a huge advantage here. And yeah, Petrova also really helps when looking at the two holy ores. So at some point you have to interact with the opponent, especially when you are being a bit slower than like a 40 card version, because you don't see like the cards you need on curve that often. So yeah, Petrova really helping and running over some enemy creatures when you play Holy Orb, or when the Holy Orb is in the shields, then you follow it up with a Petrova next turn and can clear most of the opponent's board. So when you would go down in cards here, there are some easy like cuts to make. As I said earlier, you would cut like the Slash Chargers, cut a Locomotiva, cut a Lost Soul, cut a Tornado Flame, for example. In the nature section, there's basically nothing you could cut anymore. Maybe like the one Miraculous Rebirth, but Rebirth also a fire card, so yeah, cut a Belix. And if you cut these cards and go down, then it's even more hard to fit in something like Petrova. You can cut like one Rias, for example. Maybe cut one Phobos, because in my opinion you would rather go off with the factory shell than with the Phobos. You don't have like, if you look at the Phobos control version, the first card the Phobos is searching is usually if they are not like in a pinch and they need to like discard or need to destroy opponent's creatures, they're usually searching for a dimension gate to search for another Phobos to get like the multiple effects. And basically, if you have like Fortress Shell, it's like a better dimension gate. So yeah, in my opinion, you would rather go off with the factory shell than with the Phobos. And in the games, we usually saw Otto searching, I think, multiple times for Holy Orb, which came in like 5 turns later, for example. So if you had like a factory shell in the situation, played some multiple cards, then he could search like for a Phobos and then Phobos for Holy Orb and so on. So I would focus on the factory shell more instead of like the forebus. So if you go lower, you can even cut like one forebus, and then you would be at like, I don't know, 44 cards, 43 cards even. And yeah, in my in my version, I played one in I don't know which IDC it was. I finished second. Had like a total different plan there. Even played something like Techno Totem there. But yeah, there are quite a lot of good cards you could play in the stack, and it's hard to fit them all. And Otto went also in IDC 40, but also in the IDCs before with the 50 card version. Not sure if it's the best, but I think in this tournament in Swiss, then top 8 group, and also in the knockout stage after he won 10 games, 10 matches, and lost only one match in the group stage of the top 8, so finishing 6-0 in Swiss. So the results are speaking for themselves. So yeah, for now, I think that's the best version, which has at least been proven so far. Still, I'm a huge fan of going down more in cards, and yeah, coming to the matchup in general. So first, the easiest matchup is or should be some control decks. Just the longer the game goes, the better it is for the survivors, because at some point all this recycling with the waveform, with the factory shell, control decks can't keep up with it. If they clear the board, then another waveform comes down, getting a waveform back from graveyard. So the control decks have to answer the hand and the field together in one turn, which is really hard to do. Yeah, even mana burn is hard, because at some point there are only survivors in the mana zone. And when you are destroying the survivors with the fortress shell or with the miraculous plague, they are coming back again with the graveworm, so not a good matchup there again. Maybe some control deck with upheaval is good against survival, because survivors usually passive. They stack up the board, search for Gargantua for the wins, so control decks have some time to establish their own win condition. But if the win condition is I burn 2 mana a turn, and then yeah, at some point I run out of gas, that's not enough. But if it's like a one shot, like an upheaval, and suddenly your opponent can search and recycle all they want, but they can't really play them down again. So yeah, upheaval Bliss Totem deck should be nice against survivor. But yeah, this is nowhere to be seen so far. Also, some Hydro Hurricane deck can be nice if it has like a dream curve of like Giga Slug into Giga Balza into Giga Salt. So discarding 3 cards by turn 5, and yeah, continuing to discard when the opponent is searching or recycling them back, and they can't really get their field going. And if the opponent is sticking like the Rias after, or just establishing board presence by themselves, then playing Hydro Hurricane, continue to discard, keeping the opponent low on mana, low on resources. This could also be like a really good matchup. But if Hydro Hurricane doesn't like see the dream curve, or also needs a bit too long to disrupt the opponent, at some point it's like a switch is flipped, and then it's just too late to go with your own game plan, and just like preventing the opponent like turn by turn bouncing their factory shell or graveworm. That is not enough. Against mid-range decks, it really depends on which mid-range decks there are. Like if we take the Ice Sword, no fire, so and again a bit slower. They can't really like flip the switch and go aggro. Like there are no speed attackers except for like one fighter Duel Fang. So should be a pretty bad matchup for the Ice Sword player. If you look at something like Grub mid-range, for example. I think this is a good matchup for the Grub mid-range deck because it's playing Searing Wave, so Blossom Trap into Searing Wave can be nice. Also has some speed attackers like Jagalzor, can start going aggressive with Buzzard Gazelle, with Pyrofighter Magnus. Rebirth on the opponent's factory shell for their Jagalzor is pretty good. So in mid range, it really depends what the opponent's deck is, and even when playing against something like Grip mid range or Grip Control, like the Rebirth, like my Rebirth version, it's also pretty hard. I think it was in like CIDC 4 or something where I played against Talfa with Survivors, and I just played like Rebirth onto his factory shell for 4 boss, getting my next Rebirth out of the deck, and then Rebirth on Graveworm for my Fall, getting Rebirth back from the graveyard. This deck really struggles also against opponents' Rebirth cards. Also this loop can be if the opponent is playing Rebirth after Rebirth. And then also they have to finish the game at some point. You can't really just play Rebirth and then wait, because the opponent is getting their cards back, which are getting destroyed, and they will just continue to develop, but they are always like one turn behind you if you like Rebirth their creature for your creature, and so on. You always go like plus two in the process. At some point you have to turn the advantage into like a two-turn clock, like attacking and then for like three shields, four shields, and then next turn finishing the game. So it's not that easy to play against the Survivor deck, because you need to time like your attacking decision when exactly the opponent is like at a point where if they get like one more turn to deploy all their survivors, you can't really attack again, because then your whole board is dying. And if you attack too early and don't have like a two-turn clock, but a three-turn clock, like one shield trigger from your opponent, like switches that, and suddenly you gave them cards in the hand and you are losing again. So not that easy of a matchup when you play against it. And yeah, aggro decks is more of a problem, and that's why light got added in the Darkness Fire Nature. Regarding to the Darkness Fire Nature, they play like more shield triggers, like 4 burst shot, for example, 4 pit, 40 cards, some locos, and so on. But this version focuses on like the Sky Swords, because you are already playing 4 Blossom Trap for Soul Swap, so Sky Sword feels like a natural fit. Also, Holy Orb is a nice defensive shield trigger. Aggro decks usually a problem. Maybe not the slow aggro decks, like when looking at Azonius, for example, because you have a natural answer to Azonius with your 9k Gargantua. You have some shield generation in Sky Sword, which comes down fast enough compared to a slower aggro deck, but it struggles like against Fire Nature Rush. Other fast aggro decks also a bit of a problem. That's why we are seeing like the two burst shot and so on, and the tornado flame. You could even go three burst shots and cut like one tornado flame if like your meta game is more aggro oriented. So a lot of decisions you can do when building the deck. Matchup spread, should be favored against most control decks. Should be unfavored against most aggro decks. And midrange, it really depends what their build is. And usually, like the old tradition, like aggro wins against control, control wins against midrange, midrange wins against aggro, is not that not like proven. But I think there are a lot of cards which can flip like a matchup completely. So suddenly, like control is winning against aggro if they play like 4 burst shot and so on, for Yuliana, whatever. But suddenly they are losing to like mid-range decks because The burst shots are not that useful there, or like Duel Gedans are not that useful there. So it's kind of hard to say like the rock paper scissors metagame. It all depends like on the specific build of the decks. I think one last thing, the Locomotiverse should be Giga Balza, just like a minor thing, but there is the Hydro Hurricane version which plays Chimeras and Petrora, and there is like no deck in the metagame at the moment where there is a Petrova and Petrova's calling Hadrian. So yeah, just change it to Locomotiverse to Giga Balza, and should be fine. If you have like any more questions, feel free to ask them either in the comment section down below or on our YouTube, on our Discord channel. You can contact Otto this way too. And yeah, if you have like any idea what video I should make next, you can also write it down below. And if you're interested in joining our monthly tournaments, join our IDC Discord server. You can request an invite from me or from Darksigner, and we are happy to include you in our community. And next tournament will start in June. Let's bonus IDC because the current cycle is over. There will be a champion IDC also in June, where the top 8 players of the last half year will face against each other to decide who's the summer champion for this current cycle. So make sure to check out the announcement channel on our Discord server to be up to date. That's it for today for this video. And have a nice day, guys. See you in the next video. Bye bye.